Hello, everyone. We're going to continue with our next session on the law track, which is pre-crime detection of active shooters using predictive policing systems. Before we move on to our speaker, I'm going to make a few announcements. Those of you who have already heard it, I apologize. But the law track is sponsored by the ABA Science and Technology Law Section. And to learn more about the ABA and the upcoming Internet of Things National Institute, there's some flyers on the back table. And if you're a licensed attorney looking for CLE credit, there's a binder in the back that you can sign into. And if you are a New York licensed attorney, please, you need to sign in and sign out. And then afterwards, you'll get an email with a personal link to get your certificate. There's also an ABA magazine at the back of the room, so please grab a copy. And finally, just some housekeeping. We're not allowed to take any videotaping, or you guys are not allowed to do any videotaping of the session, so please don't. And after the session, we have another session right after, so I'm going to have to ask you all to please clear the room. If you have questions for a speaker, you can speak to him in the hallway. And please take your trash with you. Thanks so much, and I'm happy to introduce Jeffrey Blatt, who is the founder of X Ventures.
Good afternoon. My name is Jeffrey Blatt. I'm a technology and cybersecurity lawyer based in Asia, but professionally I grew up in the Silicon Valley representing a variety of high-tech companies. In addition to my background in engineering and law, I also have on-the-ground practical experience as an American law enforcement officer dealing with issues of electronic surveillance, data privacy, obtaining search warrants, and conducting cyber investigations. Today we're going to explore, well, a thought experiment to address what has become an all-too-common event in American society, mass shootings perpetrated usually by a lone gunman with the objective to take as many lives as possible until being stopped by law enforcement or a civilian with a lawful firearm. Can we create a system to detect potential mass shooters before they commit their crime? You know, this is an upsetting topic. We're talking about the intentional murder of innocent people, but this discussion today is going to be objective and unemotional, but it may still be disturbing to some of you nevertheless. Also, I'm a lawyer, but I'm, at least not today, your lawyer, so nothing should be considered as legal advice. A little bit more about me. I've had the opportunity to have experienced many changes since I first became a tech lawyer in the early 1980s. I worked with Steve Jobs, Steve Wozniak, to define and obtain patent protection for the Lisa and then the first Macintosh computer and evolutions thereafter. I did the same for Broadcom, for Sun Microsystems, and many other companies. I'm also a U.S. law enforcement officer on a part-time basis, but with full-time police officer authority in California, and I'm certified by the California Department of Justice to participate in electronic surveillance and interception and in cyber investigations. I have over 29 years of law enforcement experience. I've had the unique experience of working on both sides, advising companies in Asia and in the U.S. regarding lawful government access to data, risk minimization, data privacy, and on the U.S. side, working as a law enforcement officer using legal process to obtain data held by enterprises such as telecoms and social media for the purpose of criminal investigation. Well, in the next 40 minutes, we're going to cover a lot of ground. We're going to explore the challenges of identifying active shooters before they commit an active shooting. We're going to understand behavioral threat assessment factors to identify potential shooters on a pre-crime basis for human intervention to prevent an active shooting event, and understand the concept of all source data collection, sometimes known as total data collection, and a deterministic model of the universe to predict future behavior, and explore current predictive policing systems a little, and the conceptual possibility of endpoint evolutions of machine learning to predict using all source data collection and scan for potential active shooters before they commit their crime, and discuss the privacy, the positive and negative social utility implications of deploying all source data collection to detect likely active shooters prior to an attack. And I'd like to hear your thoughts regarding the desirability of deploying an all-source AI-driven predictive policing system to detect and deter active shootings. Okay, so before we jump in, a couple of disclaimers. The subject of active shooters intentionally murdering innocent people is not a pleasant subject. The U.S. and to a lesser extent other countries are faced with how to try to prevent these events in the context of their own legal systems. Still, mass shootings are a relatively low probability, high impact event. Today's talk is a thought experiment. Can we harness technology to identify people who are likely to commit this future crime and intervene to stop the crime from happening? Now, I'm a lawyer and I'm a police officer, but today the discussion is really not much about law or legality. It's about technical possibility and social utility and trade-offs. The system we're going to discuss today is, at least partially, illegal under current law. The question really is, could it be built or should it be built? So when we talk about an active shooter, how do we define and distinguish that criminal versus someone who otherwise randomly kills somebody? Well, the FBI defines an active shooter as an individual actively engaged in killing or attempting to kill people in a confined and populated area. There's no pattern or method to their selection of the victims. Take a moment to look at the people in this slide. Can you identify the active shooter? Look at it carefully. Take your time. Okay, the answer is that every one of the people shown in the previous slide is or was an active shooter. There's no profile of an active shooter. Active shootings, of course, are not new. They've occurred for many decades, but the frequency has increased despite firearm purchase and possession becoming more restrictive in many states. And in addition, what constitutes an active shooting for statistical purposes, well, it's subject to a definitional difference. And in our particular example here, details do matter. But for our discussion today, we don't have to dig into a lot of those details. We just have to hit some key points. The U.S. Secret Service and other researchers have done a lot of work in the area of active shooter threat assessment, both in general and in regard to targeted school violence. The FBI has taken a similar approach called mobilization indicators as related to terrorism. As we're going to discuss today, the key to the work the Secret Service has done relates to the quantification of specific behavioral threat indicators that a person's behavior can be benchmarked against. A scoring or a weighting system can be defined, and if a particular threshold is passed, then a multidisciplinary team of humans can make an assessment based on the data and follow up for potential intervention. That doesn't necessarily mean an arrest, by the way. It can be other social assistance and perhaps just observation. The behavioral threat indicators would be publicly known, they're quantifiable, they can be vetted by third parties, and they're transparent. This is important because, as we discuss the automation of this system, it's important that we not even inadvertently interject bias as much as possible as part of the algorithmic system. Okay, quick recap then before we move on. There's no profile of an active shooter. Men and women, majority have been men, have committed that crime. Different ethnicities, really across the spectrum, have been active shooters. And ages vary anywhere from 11 years old to 88 years old. In terms of weapons, we are talking about shooting as opposed to a mass casualty event where bombing or a vehicle might be involved. But in terms of shootings, about 56% have been committed, active shooters have been committed by handguns, about 43% by rifles and shotguns. The point being, though, is that as we look at this, the focus must be on behavior to identify a potential active shooter. Behavioral threat assessment, that approach focuses on pre-crime behavior to detect individuals who exhibit behaviors indicative of a person who is likely planning or considering committing an active shooting or other mass casualty event. Now, a lot of work has been done in this area, the Secret Service being one of the agencies that has done the work, but if you Google this, and I would encourage all of you to do it, you're going to see there's a lot of material out there, and it's been around for a while. Here are some examples of behavioral threat indicators. They're not in any particular order, and not one behavior is really dispositive. We're looking at a sufficient number of these behaviors exhibited by a person to reach a certain threshold. And unfortunately, we don't have time today to do a deep dive into these, but there are examples of active shooters that exhibited each of these behaviors. Now let's take a look. A pathway warning behavior is a behavior that is part of the research, planning, or implementation by a person of an attack. A fixation warning behavior is any behavior that indicates an increasing pathological preoccupation with a specific cause or a specific person. Identification warning behavior. This is somebody who desires to be a pseudo-commando. Many times there's a close association with law enforcement, even though they're not part of law enforcement or the military, with weapons. They identify oneself as an agent of change to advance a cause or a belief. And many, many times they identify themselves with previous attackers. There's many examples of that. Novel aggression warning behavior is when a person takes that first step into aggression. It's like a personal experiment in aggression by an individual. Like, for example, sudden minor cruelty to animals or vandalism or perhaps even road rage. It's not related to targeted violence or an active shooting per se. Last resort warning behavior. Well, that's somebody who's just like down, just like no spark in their life. Friends and family may notice that. It might be indicative of what they post on social media. Communicated threat warning behavior. This is a situation, a behavior, where the subject directly threatens a target, and that may very well be on social media. Or leakage warning behavior. It's leakage in the context of a threat assessment, meaning that it's a communication to a third party by an individual. Usually other people, but the means of communication can vary. It could be a letter, a diary, a journal, a blog, a video posted on the internet, other social media formats. Leakage is a type of warning behavior that typically infers some preoccupation with a particular target and may signal the research, planning, and implementation of attack. In other words, another warning behavior. Okay, but for our purposes today as we move on, the important point is that behavioral threat indicators manifest themselves as data inputs. Here's some examples of data inputs: social media posts, electronic communications like email, text messages, web search histories, medical history, for example, psychological meetings with psychologists or psychiatrists or school counselors. Financial transactions, which might be the purchase of firearms or other material in preparation for an attack. School behavior records, friends and family, that many times is reflected on social media. Of course, there's criminal justice history, police contacts, but what about phone calls? Public and private digital surveillance systems. Basically, there are many sources of data that are related to the many and varied threat indicators. So, instead of a human team out looking out for these signs of behavioral threat indicators in a rather kind of hit and miss fashion, even in a defined population like a high school, could a data processing system potentially identify an active shooter before a crime took place? Well, let's step back for a moment. Let's talk just a little bit about some theory. So, the deterministic model of the universe in a nutshell. It sounds like a philosophy course, huh? Well, the premise is basically that with enough data, the actions of the universe and all things it contains can be predicted. Actions appear random because we don't have enough data to fully understand and model a particular system. If you knew everything about a thing or a person down to the molecular level, and all of his or her actions, both past and present, could you predict what that person would do in the future? And aside from actions at a quantum level, the answer, at least from a physics perspective, is with sufficient data, you can actually get pretty close, at least the theory says. But from an intelligence collection and analysis perspective, we call this all-source data collection or total data collection. And of course, while today it's not possible to collect data down to the molecular level relating to a person's total being, it is possible to collect massive data sets on individuals, with the collection only limited by the current state of technology and, of course, by the law. Let's take a look.
In our everyday world, we're used to absolute deterministic predictions. Throw a ball in the air and it'll fall along an ellipse. Leave your umbrella parked on the street, and when you come back, it's still there, just one umbrella. Quantum physics is not like this, because quantum mechanics doesn't allow us to make absolute predictions about the future. It only predicts the likelihoods of different outcomes to happen, and doesn't say anything about which one will happen. Well, you might say, that's the same with the weather. The weatherman only tells you what the chance of rain is. He can't tell you whether or not it will rain. But maybe the weatherman just doesn't have good enough knowledge of exactly where all the air and water molecules in the world are, nor a good enough model of how they interact or a fast enough computer to simulate all of their bajillion interactions. Maybe, in principle, if he had enough data and a fast enough computer, his weather model could tell you exactly where every raindrop would fall. Right? This reasonable idea, that if you just had more data you could explain everything, is the classical deterministic view of the universe. And for a while, many physicists, including Einstein, thought the same had to be true with quantum mechanics. Maybe we just didn't have enough information to put into our quantum models. Maybe there were classical variables that were hidden from us and our experiments, inputs that explained everything perfectly with no need for quantum mechanics and its "I'll give you 50-50 odds on the cat being dead" mentality. Except, it turns out that we can actually test whether or not this sort of classical underlying explanation of quantum physics can exist even in principle. The details are a topic for another video, but the experiments tell us there is no classical everyday underlying description of quantum mechanics. And this means, Einstein, that the universe is quantum mechanical, whether you like it with a 50% chance or not.
Okay. Let's see if we might be able to use the concept of determinism as a basis for predicting likely times and places of future criminal activity. Let's take a quick look at current generation predictive policing systems.
People have been drawing maps since the early 1800s to try and understand where and when crime happens, in the hopes of better predicting where and when it will happen again. Today's crime maps are made by computers and fed by detailed crime data. Police departments routinely scan their precincts for hotspots, places experiencing a disproportionate amount of criminal activity. With the help of these maps, many departments simply put cops on the dots in order to prevent future crimes. This hotspot analysis has become more sophisticated, leading to predictive policing. Most predictive policing begins with a grid, dividing a city into squares that can be as small as half a block. Beginning with data of previous crimes, computer programs create a forecast for each square, estimating the risk of a crime occurring there during a precinct's next four-hour shift. But beyond that, predictive policing systems differ in their approaches. PredPol was one of the first predictive policing tools on the market, and its forecasts are based solely on crime data, what kind of crime happened, where, and when. It builds on techniques for forecasting earthquakes, with the aftershocks of a crime reverberating across the city's grid. Then there's risk terrain modeling, which draws on the same basic crime data as well as features of the city, like proximity to a public transportation hub, a collection of bars, the current weather, or even the phases of the moon. HunchLab uses the same advanced factors as risk terrain modeling and adds a learning algorithm, a tree-based technique for assigning risk to grid cells. You can think of this like a game of 20 questions. Have there been complaints about disorderly conduct nearby recently? Is there a concentration of bars or liquor stores nearby? Is there a subway stop nearby? Answering each question sends you down a different branch of the tree, the end of the process being a risk value. Ultimately, HunchLab creates hundreds of these trees and combines them into a forest to create a robust forecasting tool. Will we ever really be able to predict crimes before they happen? Maybe not. But even the idea prompts important questions about how we manage police resources.
And just one more by way of background.
A major winter storm walloping.
The bruising fight to win Tuesday's Republican most dangerous virus possible.
Los Angeles, California, second most populous city in the United States, spread out over 468 square miles. With nearly 4 million residents and fewer than 10,000 police officers sworn to protect and serve, keeping order is a full-time job.
We are playing probabilities and putting officers in the right place at the right time.
To make the most of their resources, police captains like Sean Malinowski of the LAPD and other police departments across the country are turning to a new tactic to help stop crime before it happens. It's called predictive policing.
It calculates for the next 12 hours in the future what areas have the highest probability of a crime occurring. And then what we do is we provide that information to the officers, and then the officers go out and they try to prevent those crimes from occurring.
The predictive policing program used by the LAPD didn't come out of a police academy. It's based on research by a team of mathematicians and social scientists at UCLA, trying to predict where and when crime is most likely to happen.
I'd had these ideas that really human behavior is actually really quite predictable, and that you can study human behavior and understand where crime patterns come from in a very quantitative way.
With funding from the National Science Foundation, anthropology professor Jeff Brantingham teamed up with mathematics professor Andrea Bertozzi and others to analyze crime patterns and develop computer models to simulate criminal behavior. Their crime prediction model is based on the same algorithms used to predict earthquakes and aftershocks.
Once an event happens, it triggers another event. And so you can apply this idea to gang crimes, you can apply it to burglaries, you can apply it to automobile theft. There are many types of activities for which this idea is very relevant.
Thousands of pieces of crime data from the LAPD, including locations, times, and dates of past crimes, are processed by the software program known as PredPol to calculate and predict the potential criminal activity for an area at a certain time.
And those predictions are delivered back to the police departments in a way that allows them to use it in a real-time fashion.
So I'm going to code 100 in the area.
At roll call in the Foothill area of Los Angeles, where UCLA tested the program in 2011.
So today we're going to hand out the predictive policing maps.
Officers receive maps showing the areas of predicted activity for the next shift. Red boxes on the map highlight the hotspots, areas measuring 500 feet by 500 feet that will require extra patrols.
So the officers know that's the highest probability area where they should be looking for a crime to be committed. And we ask them to get in there and disrupt the crime from occurring or deny the criminal the opportunity to commit the crime.
That's just what happened in 2011 in Santa Cruz, California, where officers were patrolling a hotspot, putting them in the right place at the right time to stop an assault.
We came here, did extra patrols, and we were able to stop a crime in progress before it got worse.
We are helping police fight crime by giving them the best state-of-the-art mathematical models and algorithms to take the data from yesterday and today and figure out what's going to happen tomorrow in the field.
With mathematics and social sciences, police have a new weapon in their arsenal, helping not only to protect and serve, but also to predict a crime before it happens.
Okay, current systems are actually rather basic. They've been shown to be somewhat effective in predicting likely types of crimes, locations, and in some instances, groups of individuals that may be committing a crime at a particular place and time, such that police resources can then be allocated to the affected locations to basically suppress the crime before it takes place. There are a number of different types of predictive policing systems, as we've seen, but they all rely on historic crime or other environmental data. Neither of the systems that we've just watched in the last two videos rely on data related to a specific individual's behavior, past or present. There was a Chicago experiment that did track individuals arrested for crimes and victims, but it's now been discontinued for insufficient accuracy and also the manner in which that test was done. Now, current predictive policing systems are not without controversy as well. There are issues and concerns that the systems have inherent racial and/or socioeconomic bias and effectively profile certain races or subsets of society. The argument is that the data sets are valid, but the algorithms have inherent bias. Civil rights groups and others are targeting the algorithms, arguing that transparency demands they not be secret. As these predictive policing systems are deployed in the West, the algorithms will most definitely be subject to analysis and challenge, unlike places like China or other non-Western countries. Okay, so with all that background, what if we created a predictive policing system focused on active shooter behavior threat indicators? Now, let's put all, and I really mean all, legal and ethical issues aside for the moment, and let's just do a thought experiment. What if we turned the current generation predictive policing on its head, and let's focus on pre-crime behavior of individuals? Not just some individuals for this thought experiment. Let's think about every single person in the United States, perhaps with some upper and lower age brackets, like not younger than 10, not older than 90, and maybe some physical requirements, those people that cannot physically conduct an active shooting. Maybe we could take them out. And then we provide the system, again, it's a thought experiment, with a list of databases, like, for example, social media, medical HIPAA protected data, academic, employment, discipline, and criminal justice data, financial and credit card data, DMV data, automatic license plate reader data, facial recognition data, I mean, everything. Let's just throw it all in for this thought experiment. I know it'll be illegal without consent to throw some to include these some of these data sets, but let's just say you could. And then we teach that machine learning system to scan all data inputs on everybody to identify established, vetted behavioral threat indicators to connect the dots. And potential hits would then be evaluated by a human team to follow up to see if there was any intervention that might be merited. So, our first question then is, conceptually, is it possible to create such a system? Well, I asked around. I asked a well-known Israeli AI expert if such a system could be created to identify individuals who exhibit behavioral threat indicators and establish whether they go over a particular threshold as to identify them as potential active shooters. And the expert, in so many words, said, yes, theoretically a system could be built to predict future events, in other words, future crime. It sounds to me like perhaps the Israeli government is already working in this area, but of course he couldn't tell me that. But what about this? Some of the materials Edward Snowden provided to the public regarding the US and perhaps other governments have so-called all-source data collection systems in place for conducting mass surveillance, perhaps only missing the artificial intelligence machine learning component of benchmarking an individual's behavior against behavioral threat indicators. Well, then again, perhaps that element is present. We don't know. Behavioral threat indicators manifest themselves as data. It's all about data, like so much of life today. So if we were going to design a system, what might such a system look like? Well, maybe something like this. Note, this is a parody site illustration. It does conceptually illustrate a concept which is quite close to our proposed system. All sources, meaning all possible data sources on an individual's life, historic and near real time, is inputted into a system where the data is benchmarked against established, academically and publicly vetted behavioral threat indicators. The data is personal and confidential, but the threat indicators are public. Yeah, of course, it's easier to keep it all secret, but in the US, the intrusive nature of this system, I believe, would require public acceptance of the criteria and likely the algorithms as well. Some of the inputs, as we've talked about, would include things like website visits, internet searches, phone calls, Skype calls, emails, text messages, travel documents, health records. If a threshold is reached, the system identifies and flags that individual for evaluation by a human team for more detailed threat assessment and possible intervention. We would effectively be automating the process of initial identification of persons at risk becoming an active shooter. All right, spent a fair amount of time considering, like, but for the legal and ethical issues, could such a system be built? So what would be the next big question? Should we build it? In our thought experiment, we took the law, including the US Constitution and other legal and ethical issues off the table. Let's just put them all back on the table now for this thought experiment. Does the social benefit of a system we described outweigh the intrusiveness of the system in terms of personal privacy? Would you give the government access to all of your data, including your personal records and communications, if it would likely save hundreds of lives per year? Well, there's the social utility balance. The positive side would be we identify individuals who exhibit established behavioral threat indicators as identified by a machine learning driven predictive policing system, no humans involved. And then for those people who are flagged, reach a certain threshold, we allow a human team to decide if further follow-up is warranted and to be contacted for potential intervention and hopefully reduce the instances of active shooting. On the negative side, of course, if left unchecked, we'd have loss of privacy pretty much in all aspects of your life, loss of anonymity, and of course, loss of legal rights. One potential way to mitigate the legal and privacy downside might be to ensure that the behavioral threat indicators are publicly vetted, as we said, and that the machine learning algorithms are transparent. Now, humans would only be involved in getting access to this private data if threshold values are reached, and it would be under strict confidentiality. But make no mistake about this, assuming the system works, the system would be intrusive, requiring access to each person's most intimate details and conversations. Having said that, it might be possible in our thought experiment with experimentation to see what kind of data sets we could pull out, like perhaps HIPAA data is actually not required. Maybe phone calls aren't required. At some point, we would reach a balance, if it works. And machine learning presents its own set of problems. For example, the systems kind of teach themselves to optimize decision making. And through the self-optimization process, sometimes it's difficult to trace how decisions are made. And bias, as perceived by humans, may be virtually impossible to uncover, essentially undiscoverable in the heart of the optimization engine. This all starts to sound like Skynet, I think, but if structured properly, could putting our most intimate details in the hands of a machine actually help us protect privacy by keeping it out of the hands of humans without strict clearance or access? Remember, it's a thought experiment. So lots of practical issues, lots of practical issues. So today, we're exploring a hypothetical thought experiment based on predictive policing model that relies on the benchmarking of an individual's behavior against known behavioral threat indicators. This would be a unique approach, and I believe that it justifies some experimentation, further investigation. But note, I'm not advocating that the system we described be deployed, only rather that a system might be possible to be built, and it could save lives, possibly, but at what cost? Now, many of you today, regardless of your political views, will reject the possibility of building the system described because it is quite intrusive. I focus the system described on active shooters today because of the severity of the results of those criminal acts. And I've also been asked on a number of occasions if the hypothetical system described could be applied to other crimes, for example, robbery, rape, burglary, or assault. Recall that the system is tightly coupled to the behavioral threat indicators that an individual's behavior is benchmarked against. I'm not aware of any similar work to develop similar indicators from a behavioral perspective for these other serious crimes beyond terrorism and targeted mass casualty events. You know, as we look at technology used in law enforcement, it's a topic I can talk at great length about and love to. We have to acknowledge that tying the hands of law enforcement in deploying technology many times results in us effectively saying that the intrusion is worse for us than preventing or solving or stopping criminal acts. And I think as a society, it's okay to make that decision. It's okay to make that trade-off as long as it's a conscious trade-off. Technology in the end is really, it's a tool. So some just key takeaways. My view is technology and big data make machine learning driven, all source data collection, predictive policing system. It's possible, I believe, to do this. And certainly governments have a legitimate interest in providing safety and security for citizens. But currently there are insufficient safeguards. We need to look at things like data integrity, fairness of algorithms, potential misuse, and data security and breach protection. But the system could theoretically be built with sufficient algorithmic transparency. So I'd be pleased to take any questions. I'd love to hear your comments. Note, I'll also be hosting a Birds of a Feather discussion on the topic in a small group discussion format tomorrow. And I welcome your participation. Do we have any questions? I can't see.
So you managed to make the entire presentation without a single reference to Minority Report, for which I commend you. But yeah, of course, that's exactly what we all think of, and we all freak out. How could this be spun in a positive way?
Sorry?
How could this be viewed in a positive way other than to, you know, randomly predict things that may not happen? And how would you punish someone who hasn't done anything?
Yeah, so currently, no, it's a good question. It's a fair question. So if you look at these behavioral threat assessment indicators, which are, I would encourage you to look it up on the web. There's tons of stuff on it. And it's all been done in analog format. So Las Vegas Metro Police Department tried to apply a similar system using human beings, not an automated system. And it turns out to be incredibly energy intensive. So the short answer, maybe it's a long answer, to your question is, I don't know if it would work or it won't work. But I do know that the behavioral threat indicators are quite developed. The question is whether you could automate the process of scanning, and B, whether as a society we want to be able to do that. Any other questions? Sorry, the light's quiet.
I live in Virginia. The local state is working on some red flag laws that will allow people to pull the red flag if they see something, instead of focusing on scientific data like you just presented. Is there a way to just focus on maybe education? And at what point, since you're in law enforcement, where do you stop if you're living in a neighborhood? We've seen that every time there's been mass shooting, the neighbor will always say, oh, this was the nicest guy of the neighborhood. So at what point can you empower people in neighborhoods to be able to say, I see something, I say something, and where does the law allow them to go? How far without infringing somebody's privacy?
No, it's a very good question. I'd like to just make a comment with respect to implementing these behavioral threat assessment indicators. The Secret Service has some quite good studies, actually, in trying to implement this in the context of a closed community, namely a school environment for targeted school violence. And it turns out to be incredibly problematic, even when you educate counselors, teachers, parents, to try to see these indicators, to try to follow, because no one person, and then actually, as you mentioned, actually say something. I think these are all great questions. I don't have any answers. I'm really just throwing it out there for people to consider. Any other questions?
Considering the privacy issues and also the parameters involved, say behavioral threat indicators, parameters involved in predicting the, say for example, shooting incidents, if I can extend this question to other areas, say for example, crime prediction in general, is it a reality in near future to build a system to predict the crime considering the privacy issues?
Are you asking, because of the privacy issues, you think we wouldn't be able to implement the system?
Yep. Because whenever we think about crime prediction and crime analysis, and obviously there are questions related to privacy and the laws which are restricting the data, and obviously subsequently the data analytics part. And because of that, is it really possible to have a system which can predict the crime in general, or our discussion was specific to shooting incident, but crime in general, is it possible to predict using AI and machine learning in future? Or is there anything which is there any predictive policing systems available in US, or can you throw light on that?
The challenge across the board for us in the United States and in the West is to try to get data sets that would allow us to do some of the things that we talked about or talked about in the presentation today to see if it would work. That is the challenge, because so many of the data sets, for example, HIPAA-protected medical data, as an example, a physician, psychiatrist, psychologist, patient privilege is another issue. And these are things that we live with, and we've decided as a society that these are all good things, and I certainly am not arguing about that. Attorney-client privilege is another one. Your point is well taken. Even my understanding of what some systems, both the federal and the state level and local level, are always grappling with the ability of to utilize the data sets. And that is the challenge. And part of what we saw in the predictive policing systems as they exist today, you know, is they're not using individualized behavior for the most part, the Chicago experiment being the exception. They're all using generalized crime data, environmental data, to try to predict. I think those are inherently inaccurate. Yeah.
Are you aware of any research being done or papers being written in the ethics community on this subject?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear.
Are you aware of any research or papers being written from the ethics communities on this subject, or trying to understand people's perceptions of this issue?
Oh yeah, there's, you know, if you follow Twitter, there's the EFF, ACLU. You're going to have privacy groups that are objecting to the existing systems, and of course to pretty much anything else in terms of data-driven policing. They definitely have a point. But yes, I mean, if you were to search it, you will see that there are discussions in that area, for sure.
Well, my question more is if people actually tried to study, if these programs were rolled out in a theoretical, what people would actually think of them, or is this mostly just people's gut opinion that it wouldn't be accepted?
I'm not sure, actually.
So not a question, just a comment, but it seems like one thing we haven't talked about is the fact that if you were to build this system, that would change behaviors. So, in other words, if it isn't secret, that means that anyone who even has slight tinglings or sensations of anything that they aren't happy with or they don't want to be public would alter their behavior. They would make sure that they weren't using systems they knew were monitoring them. They would make sure that whatever it is that they wanted to feel, they could feel in a way that wasn't going to be observed. And so if it ends up being the case that they don't go to a psychologist, they don't go to the places that end up being the sources of data, then you're making them be in their own little, you know, pressure chamber. And so obviously there's follow-on effects of anything that you consider doing, and it's not just the in a vacuum consideration of this problem.
Yeah, thank you for that. And that's a good point. It's really a balance between, on one hand, we would want to make the behavioral threat indicators, the standards, public and vetted, right? On the other hand, yeah, you're telling people, well, we're looking for this stuff. The only comment I would make, since this is a thought experiment, I would make the following comment. If you look, there are so many behavioral threat indicators that have been defined with respect to active shooting and targeted school violence, for example, and mass casualty events, it would be quite difficult. And the other thing is to modify your behavior such that you would avoid all of that. And the other thing is, in many instances, active shooters end up, as you probably know, putting information out on social media, sometimes videos, sometimes diaries, manifestos. Sometimes they reference, like in Thailand a couple of weeks ago in Korat, not a U.S. active shooting, a Thai active shooting, where this individual was found to have put on Facebook. He was looking at videos of the Norway terror attack back in 2011, I believe, and making comments. And these are, so my point is that many times these people take affirmative, either make threats, they do things on social media. And my view would be, I believe that even if you make those threat assessment indicators public, people will still behave the way they behave. I think that's it. Thank you very much. I appreciate your attendance.